I'm Peter Schwartz. I'm the director of the IU Center for Bioethics. I'll take a couple minutes right now to introduce Dr. Meslin and his talk on artificial intelligence, healthcare, and bioethics. Dr. Meslin is the president and CEO of the Council of Canadian Academies, which is basically the Canadian version of our National Academy of Sciences. He'll correct me, I'm sure, but that's my understanding of it. Before taking that post in 2016 and since, Eric has had a distinguished career as a bioethicist. He's written more than 200 papers and book chapters on bioethics. From 1998 to 2001, he was the executive director of the National Bioethics Advisory Commission. That was under President Bill Clinton. Most importantly, out of all of that, Eric was associate dean of bioethics at the IU School of Medicine from 2001 to 2016, and he was the founding director of the IU Center for Bioethics. So I had the privilege and great pleasure of working with Eric for much of that time. Many other people on this call know Eric and therefore know firsthand what a kind, brilliant, and funny person he is. My mom would say, funny, funny, or funny, strange, and I would say funny, funny. Eric's talk is sponsored by a grant from the Lilly Endowment to IU on developing character for a digital world, which is focused on designing initiatives to help students and faculty navigate the ethical challenges presented by digital technology of all sorts. If not for the pandemic, we'd have had Eric here with us in person last spring, actually, but this virtual visit I'll have to do for now. I should mention that with the support of that grant, we also have access. Eric's going to take time out of his day tomorrow from 1 to 2:30 to follow up discussion with interested faculty and students on the topics of that grant, on digital ethics, on topics of this lecture, and bioethics more generally. That's a Zoom meeting. We can put the link up on the Center for Bioethics calendar. And also, if you'd like, you can send a comment or a chat to Ty Yogo, which should be possible, or you can send it to me by the chat, and we'll get you a link for that meeting. Finally, as you've noticed, this is a webinar, so your microphone and camera are not on. With your questions and comments, which we really are looking forward to, please type those into the chat, and I'll monitor those, and I'll ask questions at the end of Dr. Meslin's presentation. So that's enough of me, and now we're over to the main course. Eric, thanks, Eric. Go ahead.
Thank you, Peter. It's very nice to be with you virtually. I had to do that because my heart is always in Indianapolis and Bloomington. So it's a delight to be here. It's a bit odd to do these things online. I know it's the new normal in many ways, but I thought I would just give some remarks, and please do take some notes, ask questions. Let me sort of walk you through what I'm planning to do. Ethically, I feel it would be irresponsible if I didn't say a couple of things off the top. First, these are my remarks. I do work for an organization Peter described, the Council of Canadian Academies. I hope they like what I'm saying, but I'm not going to be speaking on their behalf. I too want to extend my thanks to the Lilly Endowment for the grant that is supporting this lecture. I'm receiving a small honorarium for that, which is appreciated. And I do want to thank Peter, and I know Fred Kate had a significant role in this grant. I don't know if Fred's online, but I very much appreciate his collaboration and friendship over the years and the support for this particular grant. So thanks very much to both of you. So Peter knows this well enough. I like to tell you what I'm going to say, then I say it, and then usually I tell you what I said in case you missed it. I'm going to stick to this script. I'd like to say a couple things about how artificial intelligence is infiltrating healthcare. I want to say a little bit about the extent to which I think they are disruptive or not. I want to then pivot to talk about how bioethics historically has tended to keep pace with a tough issues arising from technology, and what does that mean? And then I want to play around a little bit with this idea of whether the confluence of these three areas, AI and healthcare and bioethics, are somehow exceptional and requiring some novel or new approach to dealing with them, or whether we've got all that we need, in a sense, from a theoretical or empirical sense. And all we really need is good character and good virtue to manage them. That's sort of the, the twist that I want to put on the talk. And then finally, time permitting, a little bit about the future. So to start off, it's probably not an overstatement to say that there's an infiltration of AI into healthcare. The infiltration is probably represented in any number of papers, descriptions, or illustrations. This particular illustration is one of my favorites. It's a simplified representation of the impact of AI in health that was presented by probably one of the world's most thoughtful commentators on this topic, Eric Topol, from his Nature Medicine paper in early 2019. This illustration is a kind of end-to-end impact in healthcare, which captures three levels of clinicians, health systems, and patients, and has a kind of life cycle approach to it, beginning with those technologies all the way back at embryo selection and IVF and moving their way through to the capacity to predict a death in hospital. It's a fascinating illustration to capture all of this on one slide. It's also, of course, obsolete. We're now well into 2020, and I don't think Dr. Topol would be upset for me to say that it was at the very least, not comprehensive. A different version of this was, I thought, charmingly designed by Robert Sirocco in a newsletter for the future directions of the International Institute of Electrical Engineering, also in the middle of 2019. What I like about this is it's sort of busy though it may be, it does capture four broad areas of activity, patient-facing technologies. You can see that down the left-hand column. And of course, you're seeing lots of commercial logos that are those players in that environment. Telehealth, doctor-facing areas, and finally, research. Even with the 16 subcategories on this slide, from AI chatbots on the top left to hospital-based areas on the bottom right. Like the Topol slide previously, this also is, if not obsolete, it's certainly in need of updating. What is missing, and we could talk about that later on during the questions, is that this probably covers an inward-facing model of healthcare. It doesn't spend an awful lot of time capturing the interplay of AI in public health surveillance, in biological threats, in environmental safety, and the broader interplay with climate. Now, so much for the picture. I don't want to spend a lot of time describing what probably many people on this call already know about or are indeed working in. I don't yet have the luxury of knowing who all is on the call, so I hope maybe afterwards we'll have a better sense of that. This being the case, sort of a high-level picture of this infiltrate as I was referring to it, let's move on to the kind of a second definitional concept that I put into the title of this talk, disruption. Very sort of popular and cool kids kind of term. This idea of disruption enjoys a long history, first promoted in Clayton Christensen's book, a paper actually in the 1995 Harvard Business Review and popularized in the book, The Innovator's Dilemma. There are a bunch of these, I would say, cool words out there that people like to use, popularize, and simplify to the point of being unhelpful. The rhetorical question here is whether it applies to AI in health. Even for those who only tangentially follow Christensen's theory of disruptive innovation, it has become quite a thing. I can tell you a little bit more about what the Council of Canadian Academies, its national academies equivalent, and those around the world have had to say about disruptive innovation generally. And I think it is fair to say that there has been this rush to borrow the term, simplify it either for purposes of grant applications or policy intervention in a way to update what for many people might just be the natural trajectory of innovation. The quote that by now you've read from the Harvard Business Review updated paper called Disruptive Innovation that Christensen, Rayner, and McDonald wrote in 2015, I think summarizes this kind of cynical view about everybody coming into the pool, but not necessarily knowing how to swim. In our experience, too many people who speak of disruption have not read a serious book or article on the subject. Too frequently, they use the term loosely to invoke the concept of innovation in support of whatever it is they wish to do. The Harvard Business Review article, the 2015 piece, which I would encourage you to read if you haven't already, from which this kind of finger wagging quote comes from, lays out a few of the basics, which I want you to just have in mind and then ask yourself the question whether it applies to healthcare or not. These guys say that disruption describes a process whereby a smaller company with fewer resources is able to successfully challenge established incumbent businesses. The second condition is that disruption occurs when the incumbent, i.e. the established business, focuses on their existing products and services and neglects others, those that tend not to have an awful lot of high-generating revenue streams. Then the new upstart organization targets these neglected areas, and in doing so kind of sneaks in and isn't terribly challenged by the incumbent business. And eventually the new upstart goes mainstream, meeting customer needs, I'm quoting here, in the neglected areas while preserving the original services, usually at a lower price. And as Christensen and his colleagues conclude, when mainstream customers start adopting the entrance offerings in volume, disruption has occurred. I've said a lot there. So ask yourself before we go any further, does that sound like the healthcare world? Does that sound like the kind of environment in which innovation and technology progress occurs? Some of you may be nodding your head, some of you may be shaking your head, but I'd like you to keep that in mind. And I don't mind going out of my way, and not just because I live in the safe comfort of the Great White North, where we have a healthcare system that is not dependent on employment. But I do think that any requirement to adopt the formal definition of disruption would require that we adopt a view about healthcare as the same kind of market as the market for iPhones or washing machines. It would also require us to regard healthcare as having customers who pay for services. Again, I know there are many of you who are saying, that's what we have here. We don't like it, but that's what we have here. And it also presumes that there are incumbents, the large, big organizations who've been around for a while, and there are upstarts, the newbies. Now, there are old, established, maybe even boring debates about the philosophy of healthcare in the US and Canada, and the UK and other Western countries, whether they are founded on substantive principles of procedural and distributive justice, whether they are organizations that, whether they are countries that, while sharing a common history arising from the Enlightenment social contract theory, they have gone in very separate ways and are completely separate entities. We can talk about that, but for me, I'm going to step back from that precipice of committing the same kind of error that Christensen and his colleagues claim we commit, those of us who are not working in the field of or constantly in the field of innovation and disruption. And so just maybe a more modest definition, or at least a working idea that I've been playing around with. I'm going to sort of have in mind that when I speak about disruption for the rest of the talk, and at least imply, it really refers to something more akin to a technology that's intersecting with an accepted and known trajectory of innovation, application, or integration of technology and practice. The idea behind that is probably a little easier to get our heads around, that there are things that are happening in the healthcare environment, which have been happening for quite some time. There are regular innovations, there are regular changes, there's progress that's being made, certainly in learning organizations like hospitals and in research-centric organizations like academic health centers. That is the raison d'etre, that's the way that they operate to progress. So whether that modest reformulation or simplification of Christensen is useful or not, I'm sort of calling myself out and saying I'm not buying into too quickly the idea that this is limited to a market-driven, customer-oriented talk. So much about the kind of background definitional work. This is, and I'm not going to say what people often say, this is too small for you to see. I'm going to tell you where to find this really cool periodic table of 100 wonderful, weird, and possibly worrying ways the world is going to be dealing with innovation. It comes from an organization called Tech Foresight, and the website techforesight.com is at the bottom right. But just to explain to you what this table is, it has some colors: green, yellow, red, and gray. It lists along the bottom axis time. Bottom left is sooner, bottom right is later. Along the vertical axis, the metric is disrupting socioeconomic life. And it goes from low to high. It's a fascinating table because it lists these also in a couple of other metrics. And don't worry, I'm going to give you the examples. You're not supposed to squint your eyes too much. Green are those technologies that are in place right now. Yellow in the next 10 to 15 years. Red a little further out, and gray way on out there. And the right-hand column with the very tiny one-point font lists the organizations who are doing these things now. So I just decided to select a few of them, largely in the white, because the yellow examples that you see before you include things like, excuse me, predictive gene-based healthcare. And as I say, look, you'll see it looks like a periodic table. So the letters, the large letters, are supposed to be the name of the activity, in short form, and then its name in long form, and how many organizations are working at it at any one time. But predictive gene-based healthcare, robotic surgery, human biohacking, medical tricorders, an artificial human blood substitute. You may agree, you may disagree. The point of this table is that it is a heuristic device based on the published literature that shows there are things happening sooner later rather than sooner for some, and sooner rather than later for others. In the event that you're kind of wondering what's happening up in the gray area, that is likely to be happening a little later than sooner, but is sure to have a high socioeconomic impact or sociocultural impact, human head transplants, already in the literature from colleagues in Italy. So this is sort of the context for my remaining remarks. I've said so far that there's some infiltration into healthcare. I've not given the list. I may not even give your favorite topic. I hope you'll raise them during questions of what those might be if I haven't gotten to them. But admixed with that, we have this field that is the host of this lecture has been my dominant academic and professional interest for almost 30 years, and it's this field of bioethics, which has historically kept pace with all kinds of groundbreaking technology and innovations in healthcare. In fact, arguably, that's what started the field in the first place. It was not terribly interesting before technologies came along. It became exceptionally interesting in the years when intensive care units, organ and tissue transplantation, reproductive medicine, imaging, genomic health, health services research, big data, public health, global health, emergency medicine. And these are just some of the topics that the IU Center for Bioethics took on while I was there and is taking on now. You could fill dozens of these slides with screenshots of interesting technologies, and you probably wouldn't cover the range of those interests that the field of bioethics, broadly defined, has had over the decades. So much for the kind of historical memory lane. There has been an equivalent evolution in what you might call the tools of bioethical reflection, those tools from frameworks to principles to benchmarks to organizations to structures, national ethics commissions, and the list goes on and on. This may be one of the most interesting case studies, sort of sociologies of a field to have watched from the start not very long ago, 40, 50 years ago, for a field that didn't really know what it was or where it came from, to about 40 years ago, where people like Al Johnson, Mark Siegler, and Bill Winslade put together this charming little book in the bottom left corner of your screen called Clinical Ethics, A Practical Approach to Ethical Decisions in Clinical Medicine. It was originally a green little book, small enough to fit into the upper coat, into the bottom pocket of a physician's white coat, so they could pull it out and look at the decision frameworks that could be used for making tough decisions at the bedside. That has now exploded into a series of specializations and subspecializations that literally go from A to Z. There are people who are only expert in AIDS and HIV ethics, and there are people who are only expert in zygote ethics. And it is both charming, gratifying, and a little worrying that the field has specialized and subspecialized to a granular extent that there will be groups that don't speak to each other, that don't speak the same language, and that at a level of sort of theoretical elegance and abstractness, a set of principles really might not be applicable across, say, public health and transplantation medicine. We're watching this today with COVID-19 and the multiple ways in which the tools that we have are, on the one hand, fortuitous to have, but frustratingly difficult to translate into policy. The same is happening, of course, in AI and health, and I'll come to that in a moment. But I can't leave this point without making a little bit of a call out to a type of granularization that has found its way into boardrooms and businesses and the like. And it was the Ethical, Legal, and Social Implications Program of the Human Genome Project. Now, more than 30 years ago, the ELSI program was established. Basically, a decision made by James Watson to convince Congress that there were responsible scientists who were going to be undertaking mapping and sequencing the human genome. It was not only innovative because of its multidisciplinary approach involving, each of those letters, ELS, could be magnified. You'll see that in the bottom right-hand corner. my colleagues at Genome Canada expanded the E. They treated it as a triple play, and ethics became ethical, economic, and environmental. You could add many letters to that alphabet if you wished. But that multidisciplinary approach to problems in health and science was, it now seems sort of obvious. It wasn't obvious in the late 1980s and early 1990s. And just in the same way that on the previous slide, I described the kind of granularization or subspecialization that occurred in the fields of bioethics, you know, we now have research ethics and policy ethics and environmental ethics. So too has the granularization of the multidisciplinary approach of ELSI been new and innovative, where you have empirical people working on problems. You have anthropologists. There may not be a philosopher for miles on some of the projects, and yet the kinds of mapping activities, finding and naming the ethical issues as I described in that middle box, or sequencing them, I'm sort of borrowing a genomic metaphor of unpacking and describing their parts and pieces and bits, is itself a new approach to understanding and later informing that work. So sort of point three finished. I'm wanting to keep to about 30 or 40 minutes here. I've sort of laid out three different kinds of propositions. A lot of AI coming into healthcare. Some of it may be disruptive, not sure. We could go back to the periodic table and play a party game with those individual cells. But here's where I want to take a minute or two and try and unpack something that is as much a holding up of the mirror to my friends in the bioethics community as it is to those in the community that are wishing to develop and take advantage of those technologies. And that's whether there's something especially exceptional, something unique that warrants a new approach. We tend to have this almost an anaphylactic reaction to new technologies in bioethics, that we automatically go through a process of either finding fault, playing house inspector, or expressing caution or concern. Rarely do you see a new technology come by and there is a massive global consensus from the bioethics community saying, not only is this a great idea, we should move exceptionally quickly on it and pay no attention to any of the stop signs that haven't even been put up yet. So what would that actually look like, that confluence of exceptionalism? I'm going to be pretty simplistic and suggest that the answer is no or yes. And I want to make both cases, and perhaps we'll unpack that a bit during the question period. You know, there's an awful lot of learning that has been going on. I did not simply select these covers of reports and books because they were pretty. We could unpack many of them, but you will see here several different types of arguments and positions and policy statements from different kinds of organizations. You'll see the book Machine Medical Ethics, top left, which is a collection of very well prepared papers that are doing that kind of mapping and sequencing work. You will see the OECD's Trustworthy AI in Health cover, which is focusing not on ethical issues as we might think of them, but rather on the socioeconomic issues that arise for AI in a digital economy. Now, it would be naive to suggest, using my Christensen commentary from a little earlier, that all of these ethical issues are completely, you know, financially uninteresting or economically irrelevant. On the contrary, some of the most challenging economic issues, like whether we should be spending society's resources, are fundamental ethical questions. The same with the bottom left cover from our colleagues at the National Academies, who have unpacked this issue. You know, of course, that the National Academies receives substantial funding, about 70% of its funding, 60% of its funding from the US government, and another 30 to 40% from non-governmental sources. My organization, the CCA, receives all of its money from the federal government. So it's not so much who pays the piper calls the tune, but when questions are asked about new and challenging technologies, it does matter who asks them and how they are asked that the answers become more interesting. I won't go over every single cover. I'll be mentioning the Nuffield Council's report in a couple of slides, but I do want to draw your attention to maybe the one of the covers that you would not be familiar with, and it's the second one on the top row from the right, The Age of Artificial Intelligence in Aotearoa. That is the Aboriginal or Indigenous name for New Zealand. New Zealand has a Royal Society, just like Canada has a Royal Society and the UK has a Royal Society. That's one of their learned societies that gives input to the federal government. So plenty of book covers, plenty of reports, including the NHS report on the bottom, again, that you'll I'll say a bit more about. So lots of people thinking, lots of people saying that the thinking that we're doing is new, that we haven't thought of it before, or it requires particular scrutiny, new ways of thinking, perhaps a new epistemology, or maybe even a new set of moral commitments. So I want to unpack that in a couple of ways. And the sort of lead off to that is these few questions that would be good to keep in mind. I've been already alluding to this. Is there anything special about the intersection of artificial intelligence and healthcare that requires new or particularly unique ways of examining this relationship? Is there anything exceptional about the issues that bioethics should be responding to? And finally, is there anything that makes these issues worthy of different moral concern or a different regulatory, normative or professional approach to the issues? I won't risk shouting out to some that might be on this call, but when this note went out and it was shared with the IU community, one of my friends and former colleagues, Nick Terry, who may be on the call, sent me an absolutely brilliant paper that he published a year or so ago on some of the regulatory aspects of this topic. And it just goes to show that granularity and that subspecialization about how areas of academic and policy scholarship are themselves working very, very diligently on trying to map and sequence, so to speak, these issues. So, first answer is no. There's nothing exceptional, nothing to see here. AI in healthcare is simply another set of technologies. Some are formally disruptive in the Christensen sense and others are less so. Not a big deal, nothing to get your knickers in a knot over. Similarly, the ethics tools, principles, frameworks and benchmarks are adequate. If anything, we probably have more than we need. What we rather need is a Rosetta Stone to try and multiply translate all of them and put them into one spot so that we can understand it. But nothing, don't have to build another new set of bioethics principles that are sort of fit for purpose for this. We got plenty, thank you very much. And lastly, a little wink here, because I'll be saying more about this in a moment. The speed of innovation, the pace of progress, is really no different from other areas in medicine, with the same factors that tend to influence uptake or diffusion, and you know the same breaks. By the same factors, I mean for the clinicians on the call, it's well known what some of the factors are for clinicians perhaps changing prescribing practices or adopting new practices. They are well known. Some of them are economic. Some of them are professional practice standards. Some of them are national guidance. Some of them are one's own sort of risk tolerance and relationship with patients. Studied, I wouldn't say studied to death, but I would say we have a long history of understanding what it is that accounts for the length of time for something going from bench to bedside. And we don't need a Translational Science Institute to tell us that. We've known that for a long time. We're learning more about what that is. And the same with the breaks. The breaks tend to be the obvious things. Many of them may be post-marketing surveillance data that tells us we may have perhaps put a drug on the market too quickly, or in the worst case scenario, we may have seen a death. Nothing like the death of Jesse Gelsinger to put the brakes on gene therapy in the late 1980s. And just to sort of prove the point with something old and something new, I mentioned the Nuffield Council on Bioethics with a very nice briefing note from about a year and a half ago where they said AI is not new, but there have been rapid advances in the field in recent years, and they raise a number of ethical and social issues, many of which overlap with issues raised by the use of data and healthcare technologies more broadly. I don't know anyone would disagree with that. It's a perfectly reasonable statement. It's also not the first time that anyone ever observed that people collecting data raise particularly interesting issues. For those who don't know, Marshall McLuhan, the Canadian communications theorist, he was the one who coined the phrase, "the medium is the message." This particular quote, I was told by a friend, occurred in his Playboy magazine interview. I heard that from a friend, that the more the data banks record about each of us, the less we exist. That's 1969. So that's kind of the example of nothing new under the sun. In fact, one could sort of do the mapping sequencing activity I mentioned earlier with the IEEE slide, and just go very quickly down the list and say, here are a bunch of issues that these topics raise: consent to treatment, discrimination, identifiability, privacy and confidentiality, commercialization and equity access. But wait, there's more. And we could probably include a number of other tablets listing a half a dozen or so issues. None of the topics on these two tablets are especially new. They may be applied in very different ways, but I don't know whether that makes them exceptional. Good, I'm seeing people raising their hand. That means that I'm either exciting people or embarrassing them. At least no one's interrupting me during this, which is what I really like about this particular debate. That was the no. Yeah, in fact, there's a completely opposite view, and there is a difference that matters. That matters very much, and I just want to flesh out a few of those for you. That speed topic I alluded to, let's not be so, forgive the pun, let's not be so quick to judge that the pace of progress is pretty much the same as it always has been. And I'm not even referring here to Moore's Law and microprocessing speed. There may be something about speed here that we need to pay attention to. The second is what I'm going to refer to as the horizontality of innovation. And this means across disciplines, not only within health. And then finally, no single set of tools, frameworks, or principles are nimble enough to be sufficiently responsive. So I'm getting close to my end time, Peter, and we'll be ready for questions. I hope the timing's working well for everyone. My first point about speed, I take from a book that I read a number of years ago, and I'm sure others of you know Thomas Friedman, the New York Times columnist and author. But I found this observation particularly poignant, given that there certainly has been a pace that has been manageable in many of the areas of science and technology that healthcare has enjoyed. There was a half a dozen heart transplants before Christian Barnard successfully transplanted Louis Washkansky. There weren't 5,000 of them happening at the same time. We have a model of introducing new technologies sort of one at a time, a few at a time, and taking stock. But I think Friedman's observation, which is not limited to AI, let alone even healthcare, is that the pace of our capacity to understand a technology, which through academic scholarship and even policy engagement does have a kind of a life cycle of learning and understanding, objections, a dialogue, a debate, experimentation, evaluation, that has a certain amount of build-out time. And yet when technologies are recycling and occurring much more quickly, the kind of fail quickly model that innovation philosophy promotes, it's certainly in the startup world, then the quote, if it's true that it now takes 10 to 15 years to understand a new technology and then build out new laws and regulations to safeguard society, how do we regulate when the technology has come and gone in 5 to 7 years? So you're always playing catch up. I think you could apply that same sort of philosophy, if you will, the philosophy of the progress of understanding to ethical reflections. I was going to take this next slide out, but it's just too cool that I have to include it. In that same book, page 32, Astro Teller, who was Edward Teller's grandson, for those who know about the former physicist, sort of gave his view about what these curves look like, that technology moving in a kind of hockey stick type model from bottom left to top right, and human adaptability or adaptation curve being somewhat more flat. So the big challenge is this learning faster, governing smarter sort of intersection. He's been criticized for the slide, and I'm not going to defend it one way or the other. But as a heuristic device, I do think it provides a kind of useful reminder that things are going faster, or they seem to be going faster. It wasn't just a couple of years ago that we were talking about CRISPR, and now everybody is, you can order it online, that sort of thing. So let me move on to kind of the second point, which using an Indiana silo I thought might be charming. And this is the point about horizontality. And I have two slides using exactly the same silos, but with different labels to make this point. The first is what I think should be obvious, and that is these areas, if I can call them that, are topical areas. And using the rule of only limiting it to the number of silos in this particular screen grab, demonstrate one of the challenges in policy development and in integration into an area like clinical or healthcare practice. And that is the incommensurability of one to the other. We don't have a method for incorporating ethical principles, benchmarks, and frameworks into data and privacy while at the same time concerning ourselves with reimbursement, while noting also that the population is aging demographically. I could complete a sentence by mentioning each of those silos. But if you could imagine silos stretching out to the horizon, you would quickly see that these tools for, or factors perhaps is a better expression, a better term, the factors that influence the pace of innovation, that those curves that I was mentioning present quite an intriguing challenge. Does it rise to the level of exceptionalism in this area? I'll leave it to you to be the judge. But the second, as I told you, a second slide, same silos, different story. These areas, you will quickly note, are not limited to health policy. At this very moment, I can tell you, as Canada is trying to figure out how to build back better from COVID-19, yes, we're using that term here. It has become both an art and a science of the cabinet table in government as to who is included in those discussions. COVID-19 is not only a health issue, is the obvious statement that probably doesn't need repeating. But imagine how each of these policy areas, science policy, labor policy, national security, trade, education, infrastructure, economic development, each have something to say, each have trajectories of
policy development that are not sort of managed or organized, structured to interface with their colleagues. And the human version of this is 10 ministers, as we call them here, secretaries, as we call them in the US, secretaries of various departments, speak with each other. Imagine then having to develop policy. That may be an example, and I'm not saying that that produces the winning argument for exceptionalism, but it's those kinds of things that I think give us pause. So have the ethics changed very much? Same questions that we've been asking all along. Are the, quote, the ethics any different? Meaning, do we need a new set of principles? Do we need something, a new way of specifying the ones that we already have? Are there folks that haven't been included that should be? This is a long and probably detailed conversation that we may not be able to have now, but I do think it's extremely important to keep in mind. And I'll just use two examples as I come to really the end of my remarks. One comes from just a fabulous report from my colleagues at the Joint Center for Bioethics at the University of Toronto, who focused on data as probably the primary technology in the AI suite of technologies that is most likely to have an impact on clinical practice. But they, and I put it in red so you wouldn't miss it, emphasized ethnically diverse populations and maintaining the rights and liberties of those being served. I can tell you that there has been if not a resurgence, but a recognition of the role of human beings in this discussion. And in particular, I will say in Canada, having been sort of back here for 5 years, the attention being devoted to what we call our Indigenous, our First Nations, Métis, and Inuit populations. Canada is trying to do what a number of other countries have done, both to apologize, to reconcile, and to move forward. These are areas that are not limited to healthcare, but affect every layer of their engagement in society. There are still over 60 water boil policies in northern Canada right now, and this is 2020. These are people living on what we call reserves, the US calls them reservations, where there still isn't clean water in 2020. And we're talking about the application of AI technology and good data. Forget about data sharing across the provincial or territorial jurisdictions of Manitoba, Ontario, and the Northwest Territories. We're still not providing clean water. The NHS document also recognizes that there are issues relating to data and focuses on monitoring and tracking and intrusiveness and the like. It's not that one is a better list than the other. Of the many book covers I showed you 8 slides or so ago, there are little snippets of these. Do those issues sort of warrant the title of exceptional or unique? Again, we'll leave it open for discussion. And finally, I do want to sort of close with an observation about the future, which will be limited to one and only one quote. It kind of bookends the quote from Marshall McLuhan, and it's from Hans Jonas, really one of the most reflective moral philosophers and commentators of his day, commenting on the pace of progress in science generally and on its application to human beings in particular. Jonas writing in 1969, and I won't read the entire quote, I'll let you look at it as we wind down, because this is my last slide, but I'll just read the first sentence. Let us not forget that progress is an optional goal, not an unconditional commitment, and that its tempo in particular, compulsive as it may become, has nothing sacred about it. The slides I've sent to Peter, and they can be available to any of you, and I'll leave it there. You can, Twitter's there, and there's a, you can find me in emails that Peter can send along. That's all, and thanks very much for joining, and I look forward to questions that come through.
Great, Eric, thank you so much. I'm gonna go ahead and just unmute some people who've raised their hands, just a little more direct. We'll do it the old fashioned way. Mary Ott has her hand up and I'm unmuting her now. No, I'm not, let's see, unmute. Oh boy, not gonna let me. Okay.
Really?
Mary, I'm trying to unmute you. Oh, there you are, you are unmuted.
Hi, Mary.
Thank you, Eric. It was a really fabulous talk. I mean, one of the things I'm struggling with on the data end is sort of how, and this is really much more on the, like on health, across from health data to other areas, is how data, like big data, can sort of reinforce disparities. And thinking about, you know, sort of the data, the big data stuff is a reflection of what we collect. And what we collect is sort of a policy and a personal decision. And so I have concerns as I look at, like, you know, sort of the output of big data in research and healthcare, and how, like, I feel like what we're seeing are disparities within our own country really reinforced in the big data, and tracking that back to little data.
Yeah. It's a great comment. And if, you know, your voice went up at the end, or you said, so what do you think about that? It becomes a question. So I'm going to treat it as a question, but it's a brilliant point. I don't know that I have loads to add to it, Mary, but I will say two quick things, and maybe it'll be provocative for others as well. First, I happen to agree with you. You may not be surprised that I would, but I will say that it's not limited to a particular country or political philosophy. I don't believe that this is, and I don't think you were suggesting it, I don't think this is a U.S. phenomenon, even though we've probably all read the McKinsey reports and we've all heard what the potential upside and what kind of business model this will provide. And we've also heard the very compelling and strong case about the capacity of data to enable clinicians and the healthcare system to build, to be better at what they already do, to avoid errors. There's the list is long, and the list is sort of charmingly long. That's not limited to IU Health, to Indianapolis, to Indiana, to the U.S. I think every major economically advanced country is trying to figure out a way to walk the line between acquiring the knowledge that accrues from collecting data, the primary purpose of which may not be known at the beginning, as we know, very much like the biobank story. Let's collect and then we can figure out later how to use it. But I do think that what it highlights is the second reason I happen to agree with you. This discussion, this point of big data or its use, has not yet caught up with, I think, the socioeconomic reality of disadvantaged and marginalized people. And whether it will expand the chasm, the gap that currently exists, I used a water boil example from Northern Canada, but the same issues arise in the US. We will probably find ourselves before too long in ironically turning away from big data because it has now sort of taken over us. We no longer have control. And that kind of break, the term I was referring to earlier, is the sort of thing that may make AI and health exceptional. Do we have the types of breaks to stop? Do we have the capacity to sort of put down the cell phone in a way? I'm not sure, but as they used to say on Diane Rehm, I thank you for your question.
Nick, Terry, I'll put you in.
All right, can you hear me?
Hi, Nick.
Hey there, great to hear your voice, Eric.
Thank you.
So I think one way of looking at this is that the field of bioethics, if not ethics more broadly, owes much to consensus developed among insiders, clinicians and philosophers working within the fields of healthcare and healthcare research. Arguably, AI healthcare seems to be in the hands of outsiders, such as big tech. further, the subject matters that bioethicists have concerned themselves with have tended to be observable phenomena. And that may not be the case with machine learning AI, that increasingly will be opaque to humans. So I'm wondering whether you see these as major problems and whether they are problems or issues that the field of bioethics can respond to.
Great point, Nick, and thanks for asking it. On the first item, I'm going to take you at face value that the insider-outsider dichotomy is rough and intentional, since we all know that there's, you know, shades of gray in the middle. One might have argued that 30 years ago, bioethics people were true outsiders. They were not allowed to do anything like stand next to the end, stand over there, don't touch anything, and speak when you're spoken to. And that certainly changed over 20 or 30 years as the field professionalized. But I absolutely take your point. And it was sort of riffing a bit on what Mary had said, and indeed what the JCB folks wrote in their paper from a couple of years ago about disadvantaged people. The insider-outsider model of researchers and clinicians versus the outside, versus those who are generating the revenue, designing, building, business folks, hackers and the like, is I think a comfortable and easy dichotomy. But I think it's even more complicated, as I suspect if your face was on the screen, you might be nodding. And that is because those who are affected by this is a much wider universe. It's easy to talk about clinical ethics and end of life care when really the only people who care about it are the folks who are planning to die later and they may or may not care about it or are in the midst of this. Same with research ethics, same with many of the other issues. So this is an odd form of democratization. And I say odd form because it's not intentionally democratizing, but it is the equivalent of kind of a citizen engagement activity. They're the real, they will soon be the real outsiders, those who are affected by this. And whether there are ways to do it, I think you were alluding to some of the deliberative models of the ways in which we can express support for these developments or not. I, for one, am a little skeptical about voting, and I'm not being cheeky about the US election. I mean, I'm really skeptical about having to wait 2 or 3 years to vote for or against the policy of the legislative body or government that you voted for or didn't vote for last time can be assessed. These are happening in real time. So it's not only who's at the table, but what tools are we giving them? Regarding the second point, again, I'm finding myself in agreement with you about observable and not, although I think we do have some analogs or at least some case studies to borrow from. Genomics did an awful lot to change the way that people thought about ethical issues in research. You know, the old ways of thinking about clinical trials and sticking needles in someone's arm to test a medicine, that model just wasn't on offer when, a sample is being collected and maybe analyzed and an algorithm developed and may not be used for 20 or 30 years. But I think your point, if I'm hearing it right, is that this invisibility, or at least an odd form of opaqueness, is not the exception anymore. It may actually be the rule. And I would even add one hand up the bat, so to speak, and point out what I'm sure many people already are thinking. And that was about this horizontality concept. And that's the old, if you think that AI is having an impact on health, are you paying attention to what's going on in financial services and ICT? Are we really able to have that sort of conversation about what matters when on the one hand we are willingly allowing actions to occur on platforms that are generating new wealth for us, whether it's purchasing of stocks or the like, And meanwhile, we're spending an awful lot of time wondering about who's sticking stuff into our electronic health record. I really like the points about inside, outside, and observable phenomenon. I'm just not sure how. I'll just leave it there. I think they need to be unpacked. Maybe you've already written something on this, and I need to look at it. But thank you.
Okay, it is 4 o'clock, so we'll let people go. I suspect Eric would stay on for a few minutes, yep. Or even better, as I mentioned at the beginning, we have a meeting tomorrow. Actually, I'm not able to turn on my camera again. Something's happened. Okay, there you go.
I'm happy to take one. I'm happy to stay on for another minute or two. It's fine for me, because I know I gave two answers to two people, and there may be a couple more, but entirely up to you, Peter.
Yeah, we have another person. Jerry O'Dell is actually waiting. He'll go next. But I'll just say before anybody else leaves, just that we do this meeting tomorrow from 1 to 2:30 to talk to Eric about issues about AI, about bioethics, about policy. Eric will be available. There'll be a Zoom link. If you want to come to that, please go ahead and email Ty Yogo at the Center for Bioethics. I've sent his email around in the chat. Or you can, of course, email me. We're easy to find on the web. But anyway, we'll continue talking now for a few minutes. And then if anybody wants to talk to Eric some more tomorrow about these or other issues, please join us. Jerry, go ahead.
Thanks, Peter. Hi, Eric.
Hi, Jerry.
So a couple of years ago, I think it was Microsoft Academic announced that they had an AI machine that did a better job of predicting what was going to be an influential journal article. And then this summer, a publisher introduced AI into their peer review systems. It's not one of the big publishers, but it's sizable enough. So my question is, has it already happened, or where do you think AI is going to change how bioethics scholarship works, or maybe how even clinical ethics are practiced?
Great question, and I'd want to know what you think, as you wouldn't be surprised that I would say that, because I know you've probably been thinking about it. I'll give two answers, one directly on point and maybe one a little bit off point. The one that's on point about how do I think it'll affect, I do think that there will be an inevitable sort of asymptote towards having more and better information available to clinicians. I mean, it's almost a kind of Luddite view to think that clinicians wouldn't want to have more access to the best data in a way that's useful to them. And that includes not just diagnostic information and, you know, Watson reading everything, what's out there. But I think if I heard you correctly, it wasn't just the gathering of it, but it's also the machine learning stuff. So I, as a non-clinician, I'm probably out of my depth in thinking that it will be adopted quickly, not adopted quickly, rejected, or whether we're going to have to wait 2 or 3 generations and then say, oh, people are now using these things regularly. In fact, we don't have physicians anymore. We have, you know, medical tricorders and a machine learning algorithm that Microsoft Health runs, and that's been shown to be much more effective. I would say that I wouldn't be surprised with a development like that, but I'm old enough to know or have watched that these kinds of intrusions have a way of occasionally butting up against this sort of the point that Tuppel was making in a couple of his books about the human element in healthcare. And I don't know whether there will be a break to keep coming back to that concept that will either slow the pace of that integration to something that's more manageable, or whether the floodgates will take it over. The likelihood that the floodgates would open would not be, in my view, a result of clinician demand, but it might be a result of other factors. These are the economic, social, and political factors, insurance coverage, and the like. The second type of answer, and I wanted to go back to the peer review issue itself, like literally the peer review issue, was whether or not the model of scholarly contribution to innovation and technology policy will be regarded as highly in the future as it is right now. Because the model that that's based on, as I don't have to tell you, is really an old model. I mean, it's a model where grants and contracts and publications and citations, and Jerry, we were on a paper together, for goodness sakes, many years ago, looking at bibliometric strategies. So I just wonder whether it's not so much whether peer review will be better as a result, or even whether predictions of best papers or most influential papers will occur. I'm sure that is possible, but it's whether or not the broader concept of knowledge generation will be changing, whether there's, in a sense, we'll need a new epistemology to unpack the difference between data and organized data into information and then somehow experience that leads to knowledge. That may take a few generations to get to, but I remember seeing that announcement about Microsoft, and I remember seeing a bit of the pushback. And of course, we're all watching how peer review is evolving in light of COVID-19 and some other exceptional examples. But thanks for the question. I hope I got to some of it.
Okay, great. So I'm going to wrap it up there. And again, Eric, thanks so much for being here and doing this. We all enjoyed seeing you and learning. So thanks again. And again, anybody, please go ahead and contact us if you'd like to come tomorrow, and we'll post a link to that meetup. Eric, till we meet again, which is what, tomorrow? Okay.
Thanks very much.
Everybody, and thanks.
Bye, everyone.